French painter Jean-Honoré Fragonard, 1732 to 1806, captured the mood of his day in his painting entitled The Swing. It depicts an unknown nobleman celebrating the considerable charms of his mistress on canvas. If you understand that at this time women did not wear undergarments, then you can understand why he is smiling as she swings toward him. The new, independent, rich, less discreetly immoral society was clamoring for novelty. The birth of Louis XV's last child by his wife Marie in 1737 nearly took her life. She was warned never to have children again, and she didn't. In 1738, she refused Louis entrance to her bedroom, and although their private relationship ended, the formal marriage continued. While remaining affectionate towards his wife, Louis took a series of mistresses, the most scandalous of which was the daughter of an Irish officer who had taken up shoemaking in Rouen. Marie Louise Murphy was immortalized by the French painter François Boucher, 1703 to 1770. Louis XV's most influential mistress was to be Jean-Antoinette Poisson, known to her family as Rainette, after a fortune teller told her at the age of 9 she would reign over the heart of a king. In her financial accounts after her death, they found a notation for 600 livres paid to this woman who had predicted when I was 9 I would be the king's mistress. When she was a child, Jean Antoinette's father was a steward to the Paris brothers who ran the economy of France. He was made a scapegoat in a black market scandal, fleeing to Germany in exile, leaving his family behind. Her mother, a reputed beauty, was rescued from her perilous predicament by a gentleman friend, who was one time ambassador to Sweden, the director of the Compagnie des Indes, and the collector of indirect taxes. Charles François Paul La Normande de Tournehem, 1684 to 1751, took charge of the family and the education of Rainette and her brother Abel, bringing back her father from exile after 8 years and giving him a job in army supplies. The families, it seems, all continued to live cheerfully together. Due to the diligence of her mother and protector, Rainette was taught to act, to dance, and to sing. She could also recite whole plays by heart and play the clavichord to perfection. Rainette was an enthusiastic gardener and botanist and amassed an enormous knowledge about the many new plants pouring into France from all over the globe. She loved natural history and collected many rare and exotic birds. It is recorded that her handwriting was beautiful and legible, and she painted, drew, and engraved on semi-precious stones, which was a skilled pastime for ladies. Last but no least, she was considered a superlative housekeeper. Married off advantageously at 17 to a nephew of her protector, she promised her new husband that she would never leave him, except, of course, for the king. At Louis's hunting lodge, the Chateau de Choisy, which he had purchased in 1739, was a delightful blue and white commode. It was commissioned from the Marchand Mercier Herbert, from the cabinet maker Matthew Criard. Its blue and white painted decoration was in the fanciful design style, now known as chinoiserie. This style was the ultimate outcome, an expression of the peculiar preference for pagodas, porcelains, and priceless possessions passionately pursued in England and Europe for over 4 centuries. Our delightful 18th century porcelain group of people is from the same period, and they are undeniably exotic, but all recognisable as respected members of French society. It is painted with enamels in a family of colours that included Familie Noir, or the family of black, and Familie Vert, or the family of green. When she was told the king knew her name, Reynette set out to make sure that he would know her by sight. When riding out with his friends, she would drive across his path, a vision of loveliness dressed in pink, driving a blue phaeton, or otherwise dressed in blue, driving a pink one. He did not fail to notice her, as did his present mistress, who warned her away. However, fate was on her side, because the king, it seems, had become quite bored with temperamental aristocratic ladies, and so, as a commoner, Reynette gained an advantage. Louis XV and Jean Antoinette finally met at a magnificent costume ball, celebrating the wedding of the Dauphine to Maria Theresa, the daughter of Philip V of Spain. It was given at Versailles in the glimmering setting of the Galerie de Glace in February 1745. One of the 8 topiary trees, modelled after the old yew trees in the palace gardens, was Louis XV in fancy dress. The other 7 were trusted courtiers who were meant to confuse everyone as he made his move towards Jean. She was dressed as the Huntress Diana, and as she saw one of the yew trees approaching, guessing it to be the king, Jean dropped her handkerchief and he picked it up. And so began a liaison that lasted all of her life. The king's mistress had enormous power at court, and no one would believe that a member of the bourgeoisie or middle classes could learn all of its political intricacies, which relied not only on words and deeds, but also on stifling rituals. But carry them off Jean did, and when her husband was told that she was being elevated to be the king's official mistress, he fainted dead away. She would never return or see him again. Louis gave her a title, the Marquise de Pompadour, with the deeds to an estate of this name bearing her own coat of arms, 3 castles on an azure blue ground. She was installed in the private apartments at Versailles, and as his acknowledged mistress, she lived there for 20 years, influencing all of the arts in France. Jean was a woman of liberal views and a friend of many of the leaders of the French Enlightenment, providing a counterbalance to the conservatism of the king himself. Most of the interiors designed specifically for her have been destroyed since. However, the boiseries or panelling at the Château de Jean, painted for her by Christopher Huet in the fashionable chinoiserie taste, are still in place. At Versailles, from the moment of her arrival, Reynette directed and inspired everyone. Untiring in her efforts and quest for perfection, the arts in France would reach a very high point of excellence and beauty under her direct influence. For a long time, she had unlimited credit, and the king was happy to indulge her because he now shared her love for beautiful objets. It was a hobby he could enjoy and discuss with her in safety. His rooms were constantly altered and decorated, his visits to her rooms exciting because there was always some new project on hand with designs awaiting his approval and things for him to purchase if he liked them. She knew stories to amuse Louis, and daily they read the press together. She gave him an interest in the theatre and turned the dull, boring life of the court into one long source of happiness for Louis. Her health, however, could not endure the continual lovemaking, which all the Bourbons seemed more than capable of, because it exhausted her, and she worried herself sick with the thought that he would leave her. She sent her brother Abel to study art in Italy in 1749, where he was a great success. Architecture was moving towards severity of line, and she foresaw that furniture and interior decoration would follow the trend, and asked him to bear this in mind and to study all the classical remains he could find. On his return, she used her influence to have him appointed director of the king's buildings, and the department flourished under his careful management. Her favourite painter, for whom she became an important patron, François Boucher, 1703 to 1770, recorded many of his images of her as a sophisticated lady with impeccable style. She arranged small dinners with music or entertainment, masquerades, balls and assemblies, at which those invited played cards, drank tea, promenaded and flirted. During the Rococo period, theatres were increasingly used as settings for all sorts of entertainments, including the celebration at the Teatro Argentina at Rome in 1747 for the engagement of Louis's heir, the Dauphin, to the Princess of Saxony. Reinette loved to acquire houses and arrange gardens for scent, so that one heavenly smell led to another. In her garden, she planted 50 orange trees, lemon oleanders, myrtle, jasmine, gardenias and tuberoses, olives and lilac from Judea, pomegranates in straight avenues with trellis palisades leading to a bower of roses surrounding a marble statue of Apollo. Her passion for building was recorded in her own hand to a friend, the Comtesse de Brise. She said, "Have you heard that I have just bought the Hotel d'Evreux? I really had to have a house in Paris, but I'm going to have it knocked down and build another one more to my taste. Everyone laughs at such a building mania, but as far as I'm concerned, I fully approve of this so-called madness, which feeds so many paupers. I get much more pleasure out of distributing gold than out of hoarding it." During the day, she would not have one moment to herself. She paid court to the Queen, received a succession of visitors, handwriting sometimes as many as 60 letters, while all the while arranging and presiding over supper parties nearly every night. At least once a week, Jean arranged a travelling entertainment. That meant that everyone who attended spent at least one or two nights away from court. She would hold a party to entertain guests in houses that were often filled with workmen where interior improvements or landscape gardening were constantly in progress. They required her express supervision. The rigours of her day imposed a great strain on her health, and she was seldom in bed before 2 or 3 in the morning and had to be up and dressed as though for a ball by 8 o'clock every morning, ready to attend Mass in the unheated chapel. Madame du Pompadour patronised the finest artists, designers and craftsmen of her day. She was possessed of sound business judgment, and her Chateau Bellevue, built nearby the village of Sèvres, was the only house of any size that she completely built. The rest only required reorganizing their interiors or gardens. In its day, Bellevue was considered the most perfect example of French domestic 18th century architecture. It was classically inspired with just the right amount of applied Rococo style decoration. In 1752, Louis XV became the principal shareholder of the French National Porcelain Factory, which had been founded in 1738 at the Chateau de Vincennes with workmen from Chantilly. By 1750, it employed 100 workers, and the appointment of J.J. Bachelier as its art director in 1751 heralded the beginning of a significant period of artistic accomplishment. Madame de Pompadour also took a financial interest, and by 1753 it was known as the Manufacture Royale de Porcelain. At this time, an edict was issued prohibiting the manufacture of porcelain anywhere else in France. This included earthenware imitating white porcelain. The royal cipher of crossed L's, which had been used occasionally before this date, now became the official factory mark. In 1756, the factory moved to a new building in the delightful village of Sèvres, which was just below Madame de Pompadour's chateau at Bellevue. The failure of the architect to produce a building suitable for industrial design meant that it quickly fell into debt. By 1759, it had been taken over wholly by the king, who became its chief client and salesman. Louis XV held sales annually in his private dining room at Versailles, and all his courtiers were expected to purchase from him. A deep, rich pink ground colour, later called rose pompadour, was invented in 1757, and it was very popular until 1766. It was similar to that first produced in China during the reign of the Emperor Kangxi, but it was richer and had a very different consistency. Jean always looked after the artist who enjoyed her patronage, and she personally saw that they were paid. For that alone they adored her, as they were so used to aristocrats who in the main never paid their debts. The death of her daughter, Alexandrine, when she was only 10 years of age, was a crushing blow from which Jean never really recovered. She had many miscarriages trying to give Louis a child, and it eventually destroyed her health. Although he drifted away from her bed, they remained great friends, and he visited her daily because she was the main confidant of his life. A painting of La Petite Déjeuner, 1739, by François Boucher, captures perfectly the spirit and mood of the times. The scene is delightfully intimate. The woodwork of the room japanned in sea green with gilded mouldings and ornament. The wall hangings are perhaps woolen damask, the divided curtains pulled each side of the window that has dark coloured glazing bars. The family is sharing breakfast in this small room in a middle class house. The furnishings are tasteful but not really luxurious by our standards, and the cane chairs probably brought ready-made. The carved console table was provided when the panelling was installed. The tea table, though, was a fashionable piece and was far more likely purchased from a Marchand Mercier, a dealer in elegant furnishing accessories and trifles. It is the look of care and concern on the faces of the parents who are gazing at their little daughter playing with her horse and doll that is quite moving. It is a scene of delightful informality, very pleasing to behold, and it's in the Musée du Louvre at Paris. By this stage, the social attitudes towards children were changing significantly, at least in the circles of the aristocracy and upper middle classes. Essays expounding the nature and nurture of children were taken very seriously. For working class children, the situation didn't change, and between the ages of 10 and 16, they still lived an adult existence, as they had in the Middle Ages. They were apprenticed early, obliged to help their parents with routine chores, and knew the rhythms, constraints, and rigours of a very hard working life. Although not yet independent, they belonged as much to the neighbourhood as to their parents, serving as a link by delivering messages in the area where they lived. In this way, neighbours, artisans, merchants, curates, port policemen, all kept an eye on a youngster growing up. Raising children at this time became a community concern. François Boucher was involved in every aspect of tapestry manufacturing in France from 1734 for some 15 years. His paintings and drawings and designs after them also had a very strong influence on the decorative arts throughout Europe. La Jardine Chinoise is one of only five pieces produced from his cartoons and depicts a sophisticated lady at her toilette in an exotic setting. The use of tapestries on seat furniture and walls continued, although it was a far cry from the days when they were portable. Now they became part of the wall, fixed onto battens. During the reign of Louis XV and his liaison with the Marquis de Pompadour at Versailles, throughout Europe the Rococo style, with its emphasis on asymmetry and movement was taken up with great delight. However, it was an idiom that required immense skill to handle it successfully, otherwise its sinuous nature could turn into silliness. François Cuvier became court architect in 1725 to the rulers of Bavaria. At Munich, in the grounds of the Palace of Nymphenburg, he designed a single-storied summer house for the Archduchess Maria Amalia. Now known as the Amalienburg Pavilion, its colours of blue and silver are the heraldic colours of the Wittelsbach family, and they heighten its jewel box quality. Built in 1734-9, its spectacular circular salon of mirrors is considered one of the most delightful Rococo rooms in Europe. At Munich, in the Residence, is another jewel in François Cuvier's crown, the Cuvier Theatre, named for his achievements. It has gilded swags, drapery, musical trophies, and extravagant cartouches which enliven its intimate space. As an architect, Cuvier exercised enormous influence on the continental Rococo style. In furniture, he managed to retain the proportions before using Rococo embellishment in a style which is undeniably taken from the French original. The ebonist or cabinet maker Antoine Robert Gaudreau, 1680-1751, made a spectacular commode for Louis XV's bedchamber. The design closely follows a drawing by one of the Slotz brothers, three of whom were sculptors and designers for the French court. It is veneered on oak with kingwood and satinwood, with superb gilt bronze mounts. The top is made of serpentine marble, and the mounts in close-up are really quite remarkable. Fans were among the earliest imports of the English and Dutch East India Companies, and they perfectly reflected the femininity associated with the Rococo spirit. They were used for flirtation expertly, their decoration often becoming an exposé of the times. Fabrics imported from the East included satins and embroideries from India and painted silks from China. They were treated like wallpaper, and although costly, were popular with those who could afford them. Less expensive was toile de joie, a cotton fabric produced in France and decorated with engraved copper plates of little vignette scenes. These were very often chinoiseries. They were used to wallpaper rooms as well as make matching coverings for beds and furniture. This was an outstanding period of craftsmanship in France, and the added fun of the chinoiserie style was tailor-made for the Rococo period. Its use in decoration expressed the very essence of the style, with its complete lack of pomposity, clear bright colours, amusing and fantastic qualities, preference for asymmetrical design, and clearly non-classical provenance. Many designs are at once frivolous, sophisticated, enchantingly pretty. Louis ended his intimate relations with Rainette because of her health and took other mistresses in an attempt to satisfy his own physical needs. He still discussed everything with her, and her greatest faux pas was involving herself in politics, which earned her the hatred of the people, the scorn of her enemies, and many of the unpopular actions of the day were laid at her door. He still visited her every single day, and they remained on the best of terms. In 1764, after an illness at Choisy, the king brought her back to Versailles, where she made her will. He hardly left her room during her last days, not one word of complaint passing her lips. On Palm Sunday, while the king was at church, she sent for her priest, and after hearing her confession, he made to move towards the door. She called to him and said, "One moment, Monsieur le Curé, we'll go together," and she died. She was only 44, And as the procession of her funeral left for Paris, the king was seen to be standing on the balcony without his coat or hat in a bitter wind until she was out of sight, with tears pouring down his cheeks. "That is the only tribute I can pay her," he said. And after this, a great dullness fell upon the Chateau of Versailles. The sale of her objects filled many houses to overflowing. Furniture, china, statues, pictures, plants, jewels, linen, silver, carriages, horses, yards and yards of stuff, trunks full of dresses, cellars full of wine, over 3,000 lots, very few of which contained less than a dozen objects, and it took two lawyers a whole year to record. Her books alone testified to her wide reading interests, from the classics to French poetry, popular novels, fairy stories, history, biographies, music, philosophy, and the lives of famous writers. She had epitomized style, and her influence had been profound. The art of illusion practiced by the French in the 18th century meant that by 1764, when Madame de Pompadour died, mirrored doors formed part of the architecture of a room, and they were an important aspect of the flirtatious Rococo spirit. At the Chateau Villette in the early 1760s, a new style of decoration with classical pilasters or half columns in the Ionic style flanking superb ivory and gilded panelling indicate that change is again in the wind. The love of frivolity is giving way to more serious and intellectual pursuits, with an increasing interest in the classical past and science. Designing for the art of pleasure is about to become a serious business.